This, on the other hand, is not something new. I can't take credit for it. I didn't invent this. I'm just passing it on to you. In fact, this particular model was called the Aristotelian Model for Rhetoric. And it was created by a guy by the name of Aristotle something over 2,000 years ago, a great Greek philosopher, trainer of Plato and Socrates. Socrates actually trained Aristotle, who trained Plato. I believe that's the way it was. They're very closely related. But they really formed the foundation for Western thought. And the way we think very much today comes from Greek civilization, from Greek thinking, philosophers of that time. Aristotle kind of believed this about people. They're basically stupid. Now, I hate to put it that way, but he said, you know, you're going to have to tell people at least three times before they're going to believe you or understand you. At least three times. Dr. Webster has a saying. He says, you have to repeat something 55 times for lifetime learning. If you're going to remember something for the rest of your life, you really have to repeat it about 55 times. So somewhere between Aristotle and Webster, whether it's 3 or 55, you do have to tell people repeatedly something if you want to affect their behavior. And so Aristotle thought that you needed to have at least three times. And so this was called the Aristotelian Model for Rhetoric. And rhetoricians back in his time were actually like paid entertainers are today. They used to travel around and hold debating contests. Instead of us watching Wheel of Fortune on TV, they would go down to the local Coliseum and watch guys debate each other for hours on end, and then evaluate the logic of their arguments. It was absolutely amazing. We have very little capacity for that level of thought today. If it doesn't happen in a nanosecond for most people, or have images that burst on the screen rapidly, people just aren't satisfied. They don't have the ability to maintain sustained thought for long periods of time. However, the essay is really designed to demonstrate your ability to think. Can you think? Now, there's a part of the essay we're going to get to a little later that actually demonstrates your capacity for thinking, but we won't get to that right away. In fact, we'll get to that under the C, under conclusions and introductions. But really what we're wanting to know here is, first of all, we want to do the research that we talked about, invalidate your viewpoint, and write your body paragraphs first. Now, I don't know how many of you, but you want to write your body paragraphs first. Why would you want to do that? Here's what happens to most students. They actually tend to just write their introduction. They actually just get started, and they start writing and writing and writing and writing, and they keep writing some more, and eventually they just run out of gas. And at the point that they run out of gas, they call that the conclusion, and they're done. And here's what I'm going to recommend to you do. You write your body paragraphs first. Know what your topics are. And I'll just give you an example, and I use this in class quite often. If I was to introduce you to somebody else, I would have to know something about you. I would probably want to know your name, probably what you like to do, maybe if you're in school, where you go to school, what subjects you're taking, maybe tell me a little bit about your family, where you live. And each one of these would be actually topics. And so my body paragraph one, I might talk to learn about where your school is and all the things that you like about school. Paragraph two might happen to be about your family and all your brothers and sisters and dogs and cats and aunts and uncles and things that really you're related to. And number three might be your hobbies and interests and things that you want to do outside of school. Here's the point. If I was to introduce you to somebody else, I'd have to know something about you. And usually I'd probably want to know those three or four things so that I could turn around and say, hey, Bill, here's Mary. Mary is 17 years old, and she attends this high school, and she's in grade 11, and she really likes to compete on the volleyball team there, and she has horses on the side, and her family, her mom and dad work here, and they like to do this, and they travel there, and so here's Mary. I'd like to introduce you. So my introduction means I actually know something about Mary to introduce her. Well, that's why you have to wait and to do the introduction after you've done your topics, so that you can actually successfully introduce your topics to someone else. Without knowing anything about them, you cannot introduce them. So that's the point of writing the introduction after you've done your body paragraphs. We're going to give you more in detail on this as we do conclusions and introductions under the C of the advanced essay formula. But suffice it to say, for now, we want to focus in on the structure of the essay. Of course, the conclusion wraps it up and gives us a specific formula at the end. Now, here's a key, and I just suggest this to you, and it's in your book, I hope, and if not, it's right here, and that is you always write your body paragraphs first, then write the introduction and conclusion. Most students do just the opposite, writing the introduction first, struggling through the body, and after much exhaustion, write the conclusion with their worst writing. Now, here's a hot clue, and this is one that few people will ever know, and that is that markers know this, and they read your conclusion first. Just hold on to that nugget, because we're going to cover that in more detail under conclusions and introductions, but just hold that as a nugget. Markers know that your worst writing is usually in your conclusion, and that's where they get the feeling of what grade they want to give you. I'll show you exactly how that works a little bit later.